Welcome to the Propreneur Podcast, where we help practice owners become better entrepreneurs. I'm your host, Dino Watt. And once again, welcome back to the Propreneur Podcast, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. And again, thank you for sharing this podcast with your friends and colleagues and helping them also learn the best practices for their business as well. As you know, we always try to bring you the top key opinion leaders, the top business owners inside of not just our industry, but any industry that can help you grow your practice. And today is no exception. Many of you have probably heard about him if you were at the Ortho Phi conferences last year. He was one of the keynote speakers, And that's why I first met Brian, and I'm excited to meet with him. So on today's episode, we're going to be talking about a lot of similar mindset concepts that we both agree on. Brian, I'm thrilled to have you here. Thank you for being here.
Appreciate it, man. How you been?
Absolutely great. It's been actually probably the busiest I've been in a very long time this last 2-3 months.
I feel your pain, although it's not, I mean, I love staying busy like this, but it's been nuts. This whole COVID situation, it's been crazy. And, you know, it's been fortunately good for our business, but at the same time, I don't want to go around, you know, jumping up and down about that, you know, based on whatever people are going through. But yeah, it's been crazy.
Well, it's interesting. We got to talk a little bit beforehand, and you're a big sports fan, obviously baseball. For those that are watching the video feed, you're seeing that the baseball's on the side of Brian, and he basically, for lack of a better term, grew up in baseball, right? So you actually were a professional umpire and lived in that world. I am deficient of the sports gene, to be the exact opposite of you, but I do understand, right? When the pressure's on is when you really see who's got the game.
There is no doubt about it. And, you know, I played my whole life, and I actually growing up, one of my really good friends was Ty Garner, and his dad, Phil Garner, played the majors. He was the manager for the Houston Astros, Milwaukee Brewers. We used to travel all over the place together and grew up. And for whatever reason, when I got done playing, I kind of fell in love with umpiring. And, you know, you and I were talking off camera, off mic about this, but there was, thank God it happened, because there was never anything in my life that prepared me for you know, thinking on your feet, figuring things out on a whim, than that job. And, you know, it's funny, you don't really, I don't think fans look at the game this way, but playing, you know, if you bat 300 your whole career, you know, you failed 70% of your life, and you're going to end up in the Hall of Fame. It's a very difficult sport to thrive at. As an umpire, you can get 99.9% of your calls right, and people only remember the one, you know, that tenth of percent that you miss. I mean, it's insane pressure all the time, and it's no different, you know, business. I mean, people have on and off days. As an umpire, you have days where you just can't see pitches, or something that looks routine on TV, for whatever reason, you just don't see it right, and no different than a hitter. You go through streaks without seeing the baseball right. So it's great to see both sides of the equation, player and umpire, and it's done wonders for. From an entrepreneur standpoint, it's done wonders.
Yeah, that pressure and the quick decision-making that you have to make, right? And I just got to make that decision right now because everybody's waiting on it. You don't have time to do the analysis and go through all the processes.
It's the figure it out method. And, you know, it's one of the things, you know, one of the things we teach is that so many people in business, this is the problem with business school. I went to University of Maryland Business School, and not one thing they taught throughout all those years going actually applies to a business.
You know, that's right.
Professors teaching it that have never owned one in their entire life. And it's the figure it out method. Too many people try to plan out everything, and they take months, if not years, to try to plan out something that the real successful entrepreneurs just go, you know what, I'm going to implement it tomorrow. And if you mess it up, great, because that's how you fix it, because the people that wait 2 years to implement, they mess it up anyway. So there's no perfect plan.
No doubt. Well, that's something that I really want to get into today and talk about what you're seeing going on in not only the industry, but in business in general. Okay, so one of the things I want to talk about for sure is your ideas around business and what you're seeing happening in the industry. But before we get into all of that, I believe that stories are what connect all of us. And I would love to hear your story of how you got into the position of the business and started the new patient group, how you have it right now.
This is opening up a can of worms, just to let you know.
Nice.
You know, it's one of these deals. Yeah, I went from, I mean, I have an entrepreneur background. I mean, even when I was an umpire in professional baseball, I was starting different companies. And I ended up as a CEO of a plastic surgery organization out of Los Angeles for quite about, it was about 6 to 8 years. Can't remember exactly how long. And when we sold that company, I was on Craigslist one day and I was searching for a new lawn company, and I was on there for some other reasons. And I love telling this story because it goes into, anybody can become anything you want if you put your mind to it and you strive, you put in the right amount of work. And I come across this guy, Robert Stewart, in Pasadena, Texas, looking for a marketer. And this was right after I started new patient group, but we didn't have any clients yet. And I didn't know if it was going to be in, I knew it was going to be in healthcare, but I had no dentistry or orthodontic experience whatsoever. But I've taught people all over the world how to grow their business. So I have business growth experience. And he needed a marketer. So he hired me. He was our first client. And we went in there. We do what we do with all businesses, is the leadership and those three pillars of business success that we're known for with new patient group is, you know, the leadership and culture. We worked on, you know, the principles of running a great business, a great entrepreneur, things like that. We started training his team on sales, customer service, things like that. And we kind of figured out the dentistry and orthodontic industry while we were in it there, and then made sure digital marketing, he was doing it differently than all of his competition. And he started growing. He started having his best years, best months, et cetera. And in comes his Invisalign rep about 8 months after I was working with him. And he had just hit, and they've changed the name now, but they just hit Invisalign Premier status at the time. And he had never reached that status before, and he'd been doing Invisalign for 10 years. You know, and at the time, and obviously I know a lot more now, I'm a speaker and consultant for them, but at the time I didn't know anything. I'd seen commercials. That's where my knowledge ended. And his Invisalign rep comes in and to congratulate Dr. Stewart. And thankfully, Dr. Stewart didn't take the credit. He goes, go thank the guy down the hall. And I happened to be there that day. I was the guy down the hall. You know, if he didn't even say go down the hall, I don't even know if I'm on this podcast, or I don't even know if I have this company. It's just so funny how many angels are along the way on your journey.
Yep.
And so I start talking to this rep about our model and my history of growing businesses. And, you know, I've had, and this is not to toot the horn, but it is to put, you know, some value on the pillars, is I'm 41 as it stands today. And I've had 7 multi-million dollar companies in multitude of industries. And I had never had any experience in that particular industry going in. And we started, and so I was explaining to this rep, you know, how I had been successful with companies and how I teach business owners to do it very differently than the competition. He totally buys into it. The next thing you know, we're in, you know, Mark Kablinski's practice, orthodontist. He hits top 1% with Invisalign. And just every practice he was referring was having their best days, months, weeks, years, and they were lowering their advertising expenses along the way. And their Invisalign numbers organically were all going nuts in all of these practices without us really ever even talking about it, because we didn't really have any specific knowledge as it related to Invisalign.
Sure.
So eventually I had to start asking myself, why are the Invisalign numbers going nuts in all these practices? And it's simply because if you do the right things, you know, your treatment starts are obviously the organic winner of that. And because Invisalign has a 98-99% brand awareness right now, and even back then, they were the most entered search term in healthcare into Google. Mm-hmm. And actually, as it stands today, the number 2 most entered search term in Google is Invisalign misspelled. So people are just searching for it left and right. So if you get your digital marketing right and you show up when you otherwise might not for that term, well, that's one step. And then, you know, the receptionist then has to convert the call properly. Otherwise, you're wasting your digital marketing dollars. And then when they show up, you've got to do all the right things. And because just more people are looking for Invisalign than really any other clear aligner treatment or any dental treatment, that was the reason why they were the organic winner. And it just happened to be that, you know, then word started spreading with other reps around the country. And, you know, here we are 7-8 years later after opening it up. And, you know, little old me, I'm a speaker for Invisalign, and wasn't even in dentistry 8 years ago. So that's the story. This all organically just kind of happened.
Love it.
And I still don't understand it to this day.
But, love it.
Great. It's a blast.
Yeah. It's one of the reasons why when we first connected that I was like, oh, cool. A kindred spirit in that way of like, yeah, I have no idea how this all worked out the way it did other than the organic way of doing it. Right. I was teaching people how to improve their relationship and their marriage or their business at the same time. And then now all of a sudden here I am. So yeah, I love it. I love your journey. I love the real thing is that results are what matters, right? And people are attracted to results. There's a lot of hype. There's a lot of, you know what, you know, as well as I do in this industry and many other industries, there's legacy is why a lot of people like will gravitate towards someone because, oh, they've been around a long time. They show up to these things all the time. They're established, right? But really what matters is the results. And that's what you're bringing to people.
I appreciate that. And one of the things, you know, we would never step up on stage and call out an individual consultant or anything.
That's right.
I don't think that gets you anywhere. But nope. I think the problem, no different than a lot of business owners, and this applies to if you're a restaurant owner or a dentist or orthodontist that owns your own business, and it's no different than the consultants, is people have a hard time changing and they have a hard time staying ahead of where everything is going. And, you know, there are consultants that teach the same, whether it be phone script or TC training or new patient experience, they teach it the same way today as they did 10, 15 plus years ago.
Yes.
And I'm being literal, you know, when I say that, because I mean, I know some of them. And then we have clients that show us stuff. And, you know, it's the difference between, I think, new and innovative, but constantly staying that way. Because one of my personal fears, and I'm not afraid to admit it, you know, I talked to OrthoFi, Invisalign, and other Propel, who just brought me board as a speaker, is we don't ever want to be that consultant that becomes stale. And that happens a lot, where the message is hot for a while. And we are constantly changing and updating our stuff every 6 months to a year, 2 years max. I mean, we change our phone scripts all the time, and it's because the industry and the consumer is constantly changing.
Yep.
And, you know, and that goes for, you know, the message for the practices out there is, you know, the COVID situation. I was talking on a podcast, I was a guest on last week, the In Your Face podcast. And, you know, we had multiple clients have their best May ever, and they had their best May ever. People look at that like, how is that even possible? But the reality is they're changing. You know, the new patient consultation, and sometimes arguably even more powerful, is monitoring your existing patients that are in treatment virtually. They've been doing that for a while. They're marketing it right. The receptionist knows how to talk about it. Their website's set up right. The whole package is set up in a way that draws the attention of the community, and then they know how to then convert it. So, you know, COVID comes along, and because they were innovative, they were comfortable with change, which changes is hard. I mean, our brains, there's a few videos I like to play to our clients a lot. Our brains are actually wired to protect us from change. Mm-hmm. Psychologically, we're not supposed to change because our brains protect us from pain, from harm. And that makes change very difficult for all humans. Some just are able to get by and accept it a little bit more, I guess, easier, for lack of a better word. But, you know, it's easy for, when I teach entrepreneurs, you know, around the world, whether it be a restaurant owner, flower shop, whatever it might be, you know, these are people that are fighting, clawing, and scratching every single day just to stay alive. And when you get into healthcare, so it's one of the reasons why I wanted to get in and have a company like this in healthcare, is that the mentality from a business owner standpoint could not be more opposite than people that own a business outside of healthcare. And the biggest reason, I think, is that most, even if they run the business in a very not so good fashion, will be politically correct, is that they still make as much or more than what they would otherwise really want to. They're fat and happy. They're fine. So it's hard to go to somebody like that, or harder, and say, look, you got to change everything, or you've got to be innovating and constantly changing. And the reality is, the ones that can get through their head that, you know what, I'm fat and happy today, which is a mistake entrepreneurs make. If everything's going great, you kind of relax. Maybe you don't shoot as much content, or you don't sell as much, whatever it might be, you relax. And that's what I see in this COVID situation is, and one of the reasons why we've grown significantly in it, is that our message for the last 8 years has been changed. We've been teaching the virtual consult for a decade plus. And when something like this happens, all of a sudden people go, you know what, they're right. And it's easier to go run out and implement a new patient virtual consult when a COVID situation is happening. It's hard to do it whenever you're making millions and the business is growing.
That's right.
Right. So that's what we're facing, is people now feel the pain and they're scared for their business, which is what entrepreneurs outside of healthcare wake up every day. You know, I teach all over the place. You can't be frightened. There's a difference between being frightened to do things and being fearful for your business. And you have to wake up every day afraid that someone's going to move across the street from you, down the street from you, and open up something that just kicks your butt. And if you have that mentality every day when you wake up, I highly believe you cannot be beat.
I believe that I totally agree with that. And I think that even if you go a step further, you should be afraid of the guy who opens up across the street from you that's willing to continually change.
No doubt about it.
That's way more dangerous. Like if you have the guy who's going to come in and be just like you, okay, you can overcome that. But the guy that's always reinventing, the guy that's looking outside of your industry, which is one of the reasons, one of the things that I focus a lot on, and I know you do too, is that you grab from other industries. You look at, hey, what's happening over in the software industry? What's happening in the medical field? You have that background to be able to say, well, guys, look, you can't just rest on your laurels of, great, we're making good money. I have a great, you know, income for my family. This is awesome. And create, you have to be looking outside of your silo. That's the only way to grow.
Agree 1,000%. I just pulled up a slide. Everyone out there, if you're watching the YouTube feed, this is, or the video feed, this is our podcast studio and video production room. And, you know, the slide over there or behind me now, I use a lot in when I keynote, in that a mistake clinicians make across the board from what I see, and there's exceptions, is that thinking that all the changes happening, whether it be in dentistry, orthodontics, and frankly, they're happening in every type of profession in healthcare, is exclusive to them. And it's not. These consumer changes and this competition is happening to all the people that you see on that screen that are out of business or going out of business. And they have all one thing in common, is that they wait until they felt the pain, and therefore it's too late, or it's going to take you a lot more money and time to correct whatever situation it is. I mean, the doctors, you can relate to that being with a patient. They wait till it's too late. You know, if they wait to the feel the pain, it's too late.
Yep.
And it's no different than running a business. So just like you said, I mean, the fear is, one, someone opens across from you, but even worse, someone opens across from you that runs it as a really good entrepreneur. And it's unfortunate. I think we can all agree that it's unfortunate, but the reality of the situation is the better business, the better business person is beating the better clinician and the better practice. And we live in that world for all kinds of reasons that we teach. And because of that, there's never been a more important time to innovate on the business side. Because if you look at it, and this is something back when I was in plastic surgery, I used to look at, you know, and you're dealing with plastic surgeons that are literally the highest trained clinician on the planet. They are at the top of the food chain from a training standpoint, above vascular surgeons, everybody. And they would come out of school in millions of dollars of debt, go into the practice, and then trust their employees to do a skill set that they couldn't be hired by another company to do. And what I mean by that is that really 80, 90% of everything that goes on inside the clinical environment every single day has little to nothing to do with the clinical environment at all. Whether it be how you run the business as a CEO, as an entrepreneur, the employees every single day, they're in a sales position, especially now because of how many choices people have, you know, customer service, hospitality. I think with the Ritz-Carlton, you go through about 250 hours worth of training before they even allow you on the floor.
Right.
And that type of, it always drives me nuts when I hear, well, we're nice and we smile, we don't need customer service training. It just blows my mind, that mindset that a lot of people have, but it's changing. I do see the industry latching on to the leadership and culture, the training, how I do my digital marketing. I do see people starting to change, but again, that's because of they're scared for their business for really maybe the first time ever.
Yeah. And that fear creates attention, right? And it's like, oh, what are these areas? Look, I've been focusing so much on my clinical ability for all these years and I'm awesome at it, but no one knows because I'm not getting the right message out there. I use the example all the time of, you know, we both taught culture, right? Culture being, I think, the most important thing you can do in anything. And the proof of that is you have companies that have bad products, but still are super successful. You know, no one's going to make the argument that McDonald's is a good hamburger or delivers a quality product, but no one can also deny their success because they've created a culture of cheap, efficient, you know, not have to worry about it, like drive through. And so that's the culture you've created. That's why it's successful. So when people talk about, I see all the time on chat boards, I'm sure you've seen it too on Facebook, whatever, when people say, if you just deliver a quality product, people will come. It's like, yeah, nope, that's just not true.
Couldn't agree with you more. There may have been a time, you know, if you're the only clinician in the entire community, could that
work?
Yeah, sure, that works. But those days are gone, and they're going to be even more gone with every practice and just any business. You know, we have talk about this all the time. You know, Forbes talks about the average consumer sees more than 10,000 marketing messages on any given day.
Yeah,
we use that slide quite a bit. And every single marketing message they see is your competition. Clinicians get caught up, yeah. Office managers, the employees within, they get so caught up in, oh my God, Smile Direct Club, or oh my God, the person down the street. The reality is, yeah, those are your competition in varying forms, but your main competition is one, you, how you run the business, the culture, two, how you train your employees, and three, are you better digital marketing wise than all the other people that are staying on the consumer's mind more than you? And that's that three pillars of business success that we do with New Patient Group. And I've taught all over the world, every entrepreneur, you know, type there is that, you know, if you look at famous companies, the reality is almost every single one of them are exceptional in three areas. And that's the leadership and culture, how they repetitively on an ongoing, never ending, forever basis, train their people, which is very difficult for humans because that requires change. It requires accountability. It requires practice. And therefore most people, even though it produces a great return, they shy away from it. The second Nancy make-believe name says, I don't want to do this anymore, or we just did this yesterday. Most business owners, especially in healthcare, say, okay, we don't need to.
Right.
As opposed to being a leader, which is the opposite. I think a lot of times people think being a leader is maybe doing whatever the employees want you to do. And, yes. And it could not be further from the truth. And I've never seen, I'm sure the same way, I've never seen a profession like healthcare where the employees run the show. Yep. I mean, whether it be your company, my company, and thankfully, because we have the culture to where this wouldn't even have to happen. But if, you know, one of my employees came to me and said, you know what, I don't want to shoot digital marketing content that you want us. My response is, well, the door's right over there. You know, you can leave if you'd like. You know, but that doesn't happen in healthcare. It's happening a little bit more, and it's not about firing people, everybody out there. It's not about, you know, running it like a dictator. It's got nothing to do with it. But the reality is, if you have employee problems, it's your fault. If Susie doesn't want to shoot the digital marketing content for whatever reason, or your receptionist or TC doesn't implement the training you've invested in when you're not looking, the mistake business owners make is go, well, that's a problem with the employees. And it's not. It's a problem with the culture you have. And until you fix the culture, you'll always have to spend more on advertising, because if they won't implement the training and they won't do digital marketing the way it's necessary, well, you have to spend more and more money to drive more and more opportunities that you otherwise shouldn't have to. And that's why these three pillars drive down your advertising costs, in many cases eliminating them, while you defeat the people that are spending a lot more than you, is because, you know, if you get the leadership and culture right, then when you go invest in training, then you have the business set up to where your employees will have the fundamentals to actually implement it.
That's right. Which means
you plug the leaky holes. And as you're plugging the leaky holes, you do digital marketing right and you increase your phone calls. And then those are converted on the phones more. And it's just this evolving door to the point where you don't have to spend money on advertising anymore. Is it hard work? Yeah, it's very hard work. And it's why internal marketing produces by far and away the biggest return on investment, but it's also the least invested in by business owners, because it's easy to spend money on a postcard. It's hard to look yourself in the mirror or your employees in the mirror and say, look, you're going to work, you're going to role play, I'm going to hold you accountable, you're not going to work here anymore if you don't implement it. Those are hard things that are now a requirement in healthcare, unlike ever before, because the better business is defeating the better clinician.
It's a lot easier to hire someone and just say, hey, take care of this for me. Hey, you know, get me more patients walking in my door. And I've talked about for years, you could have the greatest marketing efforts in the world, but if you don't have the systems in place to back it up, then who cares? You can get 100 more patients walking through your door, but if you still have terrible systems when it comes to the way their patient flow is going to happen, a great sales system, what does it matter? You just got 100 more problems walking in that door, 100 more missed opportunities.
I couldn't agree more. And, you know, a lot of people, you know, there's KPIs, which are numbers, everybody, the key performance indicators. If we walked into your business, any business, restaurant, dental practice, orthodontist, whatever, and we said, you know, what's your revenue last month? How many new clients did you get? Questions like that, people know. And if you go in there, though, and you look at the EPIs, the employee performance indicators, we call it, there's a book. So everyone's a good book recommendation for you, The Four Disciplines of Execution.
It's a great book.
You've seen me talk about it. I'm a little obsessed with it. And they call them lead versus lag measures. Right. And imagine losing weight or trying to lose weight. And this is why most people fail at it, I believe, is that they're looking at the wrong thing. So when you're losing weight, most people look at the scale, which would be the equivalent of a key performance indicator in your office, is that you can't control it. You can't control production, collections, new patients, Invisalign starts. You can't control those things. What you can control when you're trying to lose weight is the amount of calories you intake every day and manually tracking those. And if that's your focus, you can control that because you can improve it through training and accountability. Right. So as you reduce your calories, your organic lag measure or employee performance indicator will come up. Now, the challenge is that if somebody else tries to lose weight, it may take them a year. If I do it, it may take me three, because you can't control all the other things that go into the scale.
That's right.
Right?
Factors.
And exactly. And that's the numbers that it's the EPIs is what you don't know in your practice. So talking about the amount of advertising people spend, even if you believe you're getting a return from it, the problem is I use the Invisalign. So when I speak all over the place, I use this example almost every time I speak about creating pain, like COVID is an example. COVID has created the pain. So therefore people are out searching for help, even ones that probably otherwise never would, they're out searching for help. Well, the Invisalign lab bill, for most of you out there that do Invisalign, you're familiar with it. You know, you do a case and then the lab bill, $1,500, or if you're, you know, a little bit higher, a little bit lower, whatever your number is physically taken out of your bank account. So it creates the pain for the business owner. So they're always looking for ways to be more profitable with it. How do you overcome it? Especially if you first started doing it with cash flow, things like that. So that pain is created. But what never happens for business owners, because they don't know the data, is that make-believe, named Timmy, when he answers the phone and drops 6 new patients this month, and if you charge $5,000 a case, he basically just costs you $30,000. If that $30,000 was actually taken out of your bank account every single month, well, you would be searching for employee training all day long. The yep. problem is the business owner doesn't know that happened. And that's just one receptionist. Usually yep. each receptionist in healthcare are losing 3, 4, 5 a month plus. And that's just one spot in your office. So as this journey from phone call to financial presentation happens, each touch point, there should be an indicator that yes, is manually tracked. We have something, it's our MPG University platform that actually has a scoreboard in it where you track stuff and you manually enter it daily and then it populates it automatically. And the point of me telling this whole story just goes back to the leaky hole in the advertising that we were talking about is, if you look at each touch point throughout the journey, phone call to financial presentation, everywhere in between. Every practice listening and every practice out there is losing $100,000+ a year minimum. More than 500 throughout that journey. But the problem is they don't know it because they don't track it. And it leads to non-pain, I call it. So therefore people don't go out and get the proper help. And the other thing, if you track the numbers properly, it then educates you. Because the biggest, I think the number one thing, Dino, that I see in healthcare that I don't know how to change it other than that we do our best to, create a company that's value and grow, is that people do not base their decisions on numbers. They base it off of, I feel. And
yes,
that is a dangerous situation CEO to CEO to be in that I feel like I need help with my phones. Meanwhile, it's your TC that needs help, but you don't have the right numbers to tell you what decision to make. And there's obviously a lot more examples than that as well. But, all this goes in, man, to feeling the pain or creating the pain for yourself. Because those numbers, if you do track them, they create the pain for you. And in many cases, it'll create a lot of pain when you see how much money is lost. And therefore, you can go out and fix it. And you go out and fix it without doing any advertising. You fix it internally, sometimes digitally, or a combination of both, and you grow. And it's not rocket science, but it's just a very different way of thinking than how most business owners do it.
So let's talk about, obviously there's these challenges that we see with the flow of the process, the marketing and all that. But let's go into the psychology of this for just a moment, because you've talked to a lot of business owners. I've talked to a lot of business owners. What do you feel is that you found is the biggest why these guys will not, and guys and gals, I don't want to discriminate against that, just any business owner, why they feel like it is either too much work, it's not their personality, it's not worth it. They'd rather put their nose to the grindstone and keep doing the same thing they're doing every single day instead of recognizing something like this, the pain of what's happening in their business, and avoid it. What's the biggest cause of that?
I think number one is that our brains literally, and there's great videos, you know, I wish we could go into all of them right now, obviously we can't, but our brain is psychologically wired to protect us from change and to protect us from anything it perceives as harmful. And there's all kinds of psychology terms that wrap around that, that, you know, we don't need to dive into, but it affects other people. It affects people at different varying states. And I think between that, Dino, and then the other piece is there are still, even with as competitive as it is today, the changing consumer, COVID, this new economy we live in, the virtual console, there are still people that run the business in a very poor fashion, don't train their employees at all, and have really no 2020 plus digital marketing presence. They're still making millions. Yeah. And their time is coming, and they're going to get hit hard. But it's hard to convince. It'd be like you coming in to consult with me in one of my companies, and I'm making, you know, let's say I'm making millions, everything is going great. And you sit there and you go, look, we need to change everything, or we need to look at every single thing,
right,
and re-innovate. Right.
Right.
Now, because I'm just the type, I'm going to go, all right, I want to check it out. Tell me more, you know, let's do it. Unfortunately, and this isn't just clinicians. It's any entrepreneur, but the more you make as an entrepreneur, I have found the less willing you are to change. Sure. Oftentimes you would think it'd be the opposite, but it a lot of times is the case. And I think that those two things between our brains being wired to protect us, and then, you know, Dr. Joe made $2 million last year, even though he should have made eight, you know, he made two, he's extremely happy with it and doesn't want to go through. Cause again, everyone listening, if you see me speak, this is not easy. Easy is paying somebody to do a postcard for you, and then you hope to God your receptionist converts it and you close them when they come in. That's easy. Now, you're never going to eliminate your advertising costs that way, and you're never going to have a full transformation of change to where you grow automatically 10%+ for the rest of your life doing it that way, but it's easy. It's hard to work on your business owner skills. It's hard to have the tough conversation, you know, with Debbie, make-believe name, you know, about how she needs to improve. It's hard to block time every single week, which, by the way, is one of the single biggest reasons I believe our clients did very well during COVID, is that, you know, we teach this, and it's The Ultimate Sales Machine, great book for everybody out there. I like to teach people to read books that back kind of what we teach, because a lot happens to not be the norm. And it's hard. So what I'm about to say, a lot of people, you have to get it through your head. Again, not a clinician, you're a business owner. And this notion that the more patients you pack onto the schedule, the more money you're going to make, is a farce. It's not true. You have to block time every single week. And we call it an operational success meeting, where at least a minimum of an hour. I see our most successful clients blocking 3 hours a week, where you role play stuff, you shoot social media content, you video your assistant setting up a treatment, and now you have an automated plug and play clinical training system because you've taken the time to do it. You come back from an event and you have time to actually discuss and implement things, and every week you improve. Yep. And it's kind of that 20 minute a day versus 9 hours a day workout theory, is that working out for 9 hours a day for 2 weeks does you nothing. Working out 20 minutes a day for life, you're going to be in shape the rest of your life.
Yeah.
And that's really what our clients, really what the new patient group program is little improvements every day. At the end of every week, you've gone from A to B, and that's the, what you're going to do for the rest of your career. And then if you're tracking the right data, your production may not come up in a couple months, but if you've got your eyes on the EPIs, those are going to come up, and you know, you're headed in the right direction. But that's why during COVID, they've had time to practice this stuff for years. So when COVID happens, they're already doing the virtual console. They can convert it. They've had time to do this stuff, but it's such a challenge to get people to block that time when things are going well. Right. So all of those things, Dino, I think is, you know, probably a longer answer to something I could have answered in a shorter fashion, but the reason why people struggle with change, to your question.
Well, it's the reason, it's like that manipulation mindset of success, right? Like we all, You having a great marriage. Why do I need to really focus on going on dates with my wife every week? We're great. We're doing awesome. Why do I need to focus on spending time with my kids? If, you know, kids are happy, I'm happy. Why are we all get into that manipulation mindset of success, right?
No doubt about it. And it's, I mean, even with my own employees who, you know, they live and breathe this company. And then my other company, WrightChat, which we can talk about it if you'd like. Yeah. But the main thing is, you know, they wake up every day, they live, breathe our clients and our company. But even then, you know, we've got things that are going really well. And I'm already in there at our Friday, our weekly meetings every Friday morning. And I'm in there every Friday morning throwing change at them. Like, hey, I've been thinking about this all week. I want to tweak this for our social media program or this for our, you know, or whatever. I mean, you name it. And I get pushback. And that again goes back to why it's hard, you know, why it's hard work is that most leaders go, okay, you know, I'm sorry, we'll stick
fine
with this for a while.
Yeah, don't want to piss you off. Yep.
Exactly. And it's just the opposite with us. Like I always say the best business owners, you have to look at your employees as your kids. Now, obviously I'm not being all literal when I say that, you know, that almost sounds demeaning, right? But the point is the same thing that makes you a great parent is literally the same thing that makes you a great boss. You don't let your kid tell you what to do, or you don't let your kid get away with jumping on the countertops or, you know, whatever it might be. You hold them accountable at the highest levels because it allows them to grow in their quote unquote career, you know, through their life and come out and be very productive citizens when they come out of school. And it's no different as a business owner. It's your job, especially in this new economy, it is your job to constantly push your employees to get better, whether they like it or not. And honestly, if they don't respect you more for that, you have the wrong people. And that's yes. A great way for those of you who go, well, is it me? Is it the employees or whatever? Well, if you push them to get better and you bonus them based on them getting better, I always like with my company, what we teach is, you know, bonus off, oh, we hit $100,000 in production this month, everybody gets X. That stuff is a farce. You know, you assign them like the Ultimate Sales Machine book, like I talked about.
Yes.
You assign that and have your team read it. And then during your blocked weekly meeting, you go around to each person and you ask them random questions to make sure they proved to you they actually did read it. And that's how you bonus your people. It's an ongoing change. There's nothing, you know, written down about the bonus. It's a week to week, did you improve? And if that's how you're focused, your organic growth numbers with production and collections, they go absolutely nuts the less you focus on them. And it's amazing how it doesn't mean you don't focus on them. You do. But the whole, hey, everybody, we need 5 more new patients this month. Or, hey, everybody, we're lacking on production this month. We need more starts. That's how most clinicians, even office managers, speak. And it doesn't motivate anybody.
Right.
And, you know, and I think all this wraps up into this inevitable growth bubble with these three pillars, Dino, that I'm so passionate about them because I've seen what they've done for my companies throughout my life. And I see what they do for our clients. It's just the biggest challenge is convincing people you don't need to advertise. You need to improve yourself, your team, and your digital marketing. And it's literally all you need.
So totally agree. It's one of the reasons why when you were speaking and I heard you for the first time, when we have had our side conversations, it just is congruent. And it's a matter of really, I believe it's helping elevate people. And then therefore the result is always going to be more business, but you're not just helping elevate the people you're trying to serve. You're elevating the people that you work with. And I agree with you when we come to the right people on the bus in the sense of, you know, I think it's the highest act of love when you realize this person is not a fit for my company. I need to let them go.
Yep.
It's actually the exact opposite, and it's breaking your own integrity when you're keeping somebody on board who is not a right fit.
Agreed.
And so to be able to share, that's a huge leadership, and it's a powerful leadership responsibility is to be able to really recognize that and go, oh, okay, because it's the people. Look, we know this is true and what you're saying about how it's not really about your advertising dollars, because as you've seen, as I have in this industry for years, the marketing, quote unquote marketing, has really been about networking. How much can I bribe the local dentist to send me more patients? And like you said, how many more postcards can I send out? And okay, that's the way that they set it up, but that's not going to give you the highest use of your time, the biggest rate of return on your investment. If you invest in the people, you invest in the training. It's interesting you're talking about the receptionist and the front desk person. As I call them the director of first impressions. And I always find it fascinating that that is looked at as an entry-level job. This is the first person that's going to be connecting with the potential patient. You talk about losing five people and you know it's way more than that. That's hundreds of thousands of dollars going out the door because you have somebody who is in a quote entry-level job that, hey, if they sound nice and they could pick up the phone and take a note, then they're good. Dude, this should be the person who is highly skilled, highly trained, highly ready to convert that sale to make person see it's a no-brainer to buy from you as soon as they come in.
I agree 1,000%. I mean, out of everything we do, bar none, the phones are my biggest passion. They are for a lot of reasons, but again, that pain point, you know, I tell a story all the time about a postcard I used to receive from this doctor, and I'm not going to go into the story right now, but it ended up being, I called the practice, it was a disaster. But the story that really sticks with me more than anything now is that, you know, when we lived in this house about 2 years now, and about a few months in, we needed a plumber. And it took us calling five different plumbing companies to finally get one. The first three didn't answer. The fourth one, the lady was a total, you fill in the blank. Yeah. And the fifth one wasn't even that good. But the reality is how many are you going to call, right? You need a plumber. So the thing is that the first three, the business owner doesn't even know they lost that business. No clue. Right. The fourth one doesn't even know how the phones are being answered. And from what I've seen, a lot of business owners don't think it's them, right? Oh, we answer the phones, or, you know, Betty's the fantastic on the phones. They're also the same ones that provide no training. So the biggest issue I see, especially since you just talked about it, you know, you're putting an entry-level position into literally what has now become the most important position in the office. And it's because when your receptionist answers, you are now the third place they've called, or you're the first, luckily, and they're going to go check out two or three more just to see if they like the receptionist better. So they are in direct competition with every other receptionist at that point in the patient journey or the consumer journey, because they're not even a patient yet. People in nickel and dime it all the time. And a big reason for that is people don't know everything that goes into being a great receptionist in a competitive marketplace. Like our on-demand phone training course is 8.5 hours of video, 8.5 hours. And it's about to go to 12 because we're adding brand new things to it as we speak in this video production room. So 12 hours of video content in order to get somebody. And that by the way, isn't intended to replace the need to practice. Like our on-demand courses, our MPG University platform that has all of our courses, they're there so you don't have to repeat yourself anymore. But yes. It doesn't replace, and that's the problem with on-demand training. I see it all the time, is that we ask the question, people call us, they're like, I'm interested in coaching and things like that. And we have various options. You know, we have an assigned coach that physically shows up to the practice. We can do it virtually, a combination of both. And we tell people, like our MPG University platform, it's very popular, but it's like you get a gym membership, right? You go to the gym and you have every single thing you need to be very fit and very successful from a, you know, looking good standpoint. At that point, it becomes up to you whether or not you use it,
right?
And work your butt off, et cetera. So we ask the question, look, if you're the type that doesn't need a personal trainer, you hold yourself accountable, you watch the videos, you role play with your team weekly, hold them accountable, then the platform's all you need, because we constantly, when we update it, we virtually upload the new courses. We're constantly putting new things in there, right? But if you feel like it's going to sit on the shelf and you're not going to use the gym equipment, you need one of our coaches. It just goes back, Dino, to the training. And that's why I actually had doctors beg us for years to create a receptionist for them. And that's why we launched WrightChat, because I view... So the future of the practice, and people think this is a little crazy, but this is where it's going, is you outsource everything that can be outsourced to people that are going to do it better than you anyway. And it starts on the phones with WrightChat. We actually have a team that's assigned to the business. They answer it as if they're sitting inside the business, and they replace the need for you to even have a phone in your office. They access your practice management software, and my employees are trained by me. So you have a team employed by me, trained by me, to answer your phones for you. And that way, more of your calls are answered, more are converted, and the experience that's provided and the words they use set that patient up to come in and buy from you day one, or be committed to your business from day one before they ever even arrive. Now, the other piece, because I view this is the way of the future, is that I don't even think there's going to be a front desk in the future. Meaning, not only no phones, I don't even think a desk will exist. I think assistants will start monitoring a lot of treatment virtually from their house, because more and more patients, especially the more and more you do Invisalign, things like that, the more and more you can monitor people virtually. Most of their appointments, they don't even need to come in. So you've got 1099 assistants instead of W-2 that work in the practice all the time. And then things like OrthoFi, who I speak for, that I think does a wonderful job, our clients that have them love them. You know, you outsource collections and billing and things like that to them. And all of a sudden you end up in a practice that does $2 million a year. You have basically three employees and you outsource everything else. And I see clients of ours do it this way now, that use OrthoFi, they use WrightChat, and they use our whole program. They're exploding, but they don't have any employees. They have very few employees and a very low overhead from a W-2 standpoint. And that's one of the reasons that we created WrightChat, is we see the issues. Training someone else's employees to be great, because it's a sales position now, right?
Yes, it is.
It literally is a sales position. So it's, again, you're training or you're trusting people in a sales position that could not get hired on any other company's sales team outside of your practice. And it's this disconnect. And yeah, I talk about all the time with OrthoFi, Invisalign, et cetera. Talked about it a lot on the podcast last week, is that there's this disconnect between companies out there that trust the practice to sell their stuff, whether it be, you know, a third party financing or a supply company or Invisalign or OrthoFi, whatever, is that they all try to help the small business, the practice, in different ways. And I believe, and I tell them all this, is that I think that most of it misses the mark, and that the disconnect is that you're trusting them to sell your good, your service, whatever it is, product, to people that you yourself would never in a million years hire on your own sales team. So if you just give and commit to giving the people that work inside the practice the sales fundamentals and the customer service fundamentals that would be required to work for your own company, if that was your goal as a company, you would double, triple, quadruple the size of your company in a couple years if that was your only go-to, simply because you would not train your own people. So in essence, they're not training their own sales team because these people don't have sales skills. And it's not a criticism. It's just they don't show up from the factory ready sell it, you know, and it's a problem.
Well, and that you magnify that problem with business owners who also have no clue what they're actually looking for in that position, because they don't know what it would be either. I know you've probably experienced this too. I've talked to many of doctors who not only have not had their own business before, have never been in that situation before, but have never actually worked for anyone before.
Right.
So they don't know how to even be a great employee, let alone hire a great employee. Yep. And the frustration is that of them trying to find the right person. Well, they're looking for the wrong person to do the right job.
I agree 1,000%. And, you know, it's been a job hiring, oh gosh, I guess dilemma maybe is a good word for it, in healthcare. And I've seen it. This is kind of this way in other professions, but it's rampant in healthcare, where, you know, you go out and you need somebody new to present money at your office, and you go and you look for someone that's had 20 years experience in dentistry or orthodontics or plastic surgery, whatever it might be. And, or you need someone to answer your phones. Well, I got to have someone that's answer the phones in dentistry. No, you don't. Nope. You know, you need someone that is great with people, willing to learn, great with customer service, sales fundamentals. You can teach them the other stuff much easier than the other way around. And it is a big, and that's what with WrightChat, you know, the teams we hire, they're from the customer service, hospitality, and sales world.
That's right.
I purposely do not hire anybody that has orthodontic experience, dentistry, et cetera. I want to train them my way with our vision from scratch without them having any kind of, you know, misconstrued notion about how the industry is or how business is. But, and here's the big, you know, the BUT here, is that requires training. it requires a lot of training, and it requires a commitment to repetitive ongoing training, no different than an athlete. And that's where most business owners, they don't want to do that. They don't want to deal with it. So therefore they don't do it that way. And it hurts them and their numbers drastically, whether they know it or not, because they may not track the numbers that show them how much they're losing because of it.
So true. So true. Okay. So we have gotten to the part in the show where we go to our six questions, rapid fire questions we ask everybody. Before we do, I want to make sure that we have covered the bases here. So the new patient group, three pillars. Tell us what three pillars are.
Yeah. Three pillars. So leadership and culture, and that encompasses a lot more, obviously. We do, sure. You know, I have my docpreneur mastermind with new patient group that all of our clients are entered into. They all, and that just real quick, you know, I think a big reason that our clients are successful and we have a 99% retention rate as it stands today is we're a family. It is not a consultant approach. It is you're hiring a division that becomes with your business for life. And you have access to me. We meet as a group virtually every single month. We have virtual happy hours. We're all going to Napa Wine Valley next March together. We bounce ideas off each other in the chat forum. So, you know, it's not like I'm the CEO, you get to hear me on a podcast, you ever get to meet me type thing. I'm very, very involved with every single one of our clients' businesses and obsessed with making sure they succeed. You know, we work on entrepreneur coaching, just a lot of stuff on that business side of stuff is that first pillar. The other one is the employee training. It's giving your employees the skill sets that they have to convert via every step of that consumer journey, from how you shoot digital marketing content, how, when the phones ring, how you convert it, and literally every touch point beyond. And then the digital marketing. And the digital marketing pillar, when we start having conversations with people, it kind of gets pushed a little bit to the back burner, even though it's not meant to. But, you know, the digital marketing world right now has changed so much, and that Google says YouTube's about to overtake them as the largest search engine in the world. That's why Google purchased them many years ago. Google now has your search terms on Google directly tied to how you do that video production for that same search term over on YouTube. There's so many, which basically, long story short, simply put, is if you don't have a robust YouTube station done right, in 3 to 5 years, you will be a complete dinosaur. You will not be able to be visible on Google. The simple reason is people watch video, they don't read now. I think the myth out there is the fact that just young people are the ones watching YouTube, and young people are, oh, we're not targeting them. Maybe you're a dental practice and you're not going after someone that's 20 as an example, or 15. The reality is, though, is their parents are watching videos too. My mom's 68. She lives on YouTube, lives on Facebook. So it's not just the younger people. It's across the board. In fact, YouTube and Google just came out with a study, is that more people see YouTube now than anybody on cable, than any cable TV network. So if you're out there and you're doing TV commercials, and this is how you've got to know data, right? You shouldn't be doing TV commercials on TV. You should be running commercials on YouTube.
Yeah.
Because you're going to get you can target your audience better, and you're going to get a better return, but you have to know the data. So all this digital marketing has changed as well. And honestly, though, that's where the three pillars, you know, that's where they exist. Because if you go in, you try to get a team of eight, as an example, to start putting themselves on video, bring in their personal life into the business life. Like if they love to cook, well, you need cooking videos now. It the whole world has changed because millennials, Gen Z, and others want to learn about you and know, like, and trust you before they pick up the phone and call.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that means it goes well beyond, are you the best clinician? Are you the best assistant? Are you nice? It goes well beyond that. But in order for them to do that, you've got to have the right culture, you know, and then in order for your training to work, you've got to have the right culture. Without one of those, you know, the ladder breaks. And that's why having them entwined are so powerful.
So true. So true. Awesome. Love it. Brian, we could talk about this stuff all day long because we're just so in the same headspace of it. I love meeting like-minded people. I love people who are in this industry who are really trying to improve it through helping people see more of the light, if you will, right? To see like, hey, it might be hard to hear sometimes, but it's coming from a place of love. It's coming from a place of really wanting you to succeed. And my dog in the fight is your success. That's my dog. And so that's where we're looking at it. Well, we've come to the place in the show where we go through our six rapid fire questions. These are where people here just get a kind of a little peek into your brain and to see what you think about this. So are you ready to play?
Let's do it.
All right. So off top of your head, what's the most expensive thing that private practice owners are missing in their practice?
Lost opportunities, no doubt about it. Not having visibility of the right numbers, without a doubt, that's it.
So true. Love it. And it's not that difficult, not that it's not challenging, of a tweak to make if you're willing to make it. That's yep. what I love. And I love that I love your explanation around that. All right. So how can people get a hold of you? I want to make sure we know that. What's the best way for people to get a hold of you?
Sure. So our website is newpatientgroup.com. You can go there. In the lower right-hand corner, our live chat, my director of marketing, Haley Shaw, will handle any questions you have, set up a time to speak with my chief operational officer, Eric Field, or myself, depending on schedules. And we're very much involved with the sales process. So I'm happy to talk to everybody out there. I'm even willing to give my cell phone number out right now to everybody, 832-331-6091. If I get any text messages off of this podcast, we'll send you a couple of free goodies, some scripting, some tips to grow your practice that we'll send you on our unlisted private YouTube station. So I'll send that out. So those are probably two best ways. If you're interested in my company, WrightChat, it's just Wright, my last name. So with a W, WrightChat.com to learn more about that. And that probably sums it up.
Great. Perfect. All right. What is a book? And you love books and I do too. I love giving books out to people. What is a book that you believe every private practice owner should read?
Well, the two we discussed on this podcast today, the four disciplines of execution and the ultimate sales machine, definitely two. And I'm going to give you a third. See, here, we bend down and grab it. Everyone can see it. There we go. And this guy's book right here.
That's very kind
a big of you. Winner. So that's the third.
That's very kind of you. That wasn't a paid promotion. Thank you.
No, it was not. That's from the heart.
Well, the next actual question comes from that book that I do talk a lot about: team culture, team performance as the foundation for your business growth. We both are very much like-minded in that space. But what do you see as the biggest challenge that private practice owners are facing when it comes to their teams and their office culture?
The biggest challenge is how the business owner runs the business. I believe you're stuck in, and I see it every day. Some are more than others, industries within healthcare. Is the reluctancy to change. And the business owner sometimes has that reluctancy as well, but I also see if the business owner is reluctant to change, or I'm sorry, if they're willing to change, the team might not, and then they don't know how to get them on board. So I think the culture of change is the answer to that question.
Love it. What's the best advice that you've ever received in life or business?
Wow, that's a, whew, let's I know. See here. I think that this one I'll go with, and I stick with it today. If you didn't earn it, don't tell other people what to do with it. And I teach that in a lot of different ways, whether that be the money you've earned or the hard work you've earned, whatever it might be, that statement can be used in so many multitude of ways. I was taught that really early on with a consultant that I talked to or hired with one of my first companies. And I remember that to this day.
So true. That's really, really important. All right. Lastly, what's the best resource or tool that every private practice owner should be using to grow their practice?
You know, I don't want for, so these three pillars, whether it be with us or somebody else, and I always, you've seen me speak, I go overboard in letting people know we're here to help. So this is not to sell, you know, new patient group or me. Mm-hmm. But the three pillars, you've got to find a resource that covers all of them. You know, it doesn't mean that you have to get all of them at once, but the reality is your story, you've got to have a clarified message from the time you attract people to the time they call and every other touch point without. So if you use 30 companies, your message breaks. Yes. So you have to get help to make sure your message is clarified in all three of those pillars. And just from what I've seen is, you know, the virtual world, you know, we're all living in it. It's heading more and more there. And it's why MPG University exists, is that, you know, the come and go consultant doesn't quite accomplish what humans need in that consistency, repetition, and accountability. So our on-demand training platform, people can buy our content, keep it for life. They don't have to keep paying every month. And that is our way of becoming a part of you forever. And having you have videos to watch over and over and over again. And I think that is a resource in this virtual world that I see helping people a lot and that I think people should look into.
Yeah, I love that point about the come and go consultant, and no disrespect to anybody out there, but I think one of the challenges that ends up happening is you end up creating a crutch. And I use the visualization of a crutch all the time. Of the problem is I don't want to become a crutch to any of my clients, because if I am, then when I leave, they fall. And Agreed. That's not doing my fiduciary responsibility. So
agreed. And it's the opposite. What makes an athlete and a sports organization great is the exact same things that make a business great. Great culture, Yes. Great coaching of the people, you know, and obviously digital marketing is a little bit different, but you get the analogy. So the repetition that you have as an athlete has to be the repetition you have with your employees. Otherwise, they will not learn it to begin with. But then as humans, we all resort back to how we used to do things. And that is, I think, even more than training people to begin with. It's the ongoing training that people lack significantly because it's difficult. But if you train Betty on how to present money a certain way, it's guaranteed she goes back to how she does it today if you don't consistently keep practicing with her, no matter how much she may like it or not, or how much you may like it or not. It is guaranteed she resorts back to having the loop in her swing that she fixed 2 weeks prior. And that's the biggest hurdle that people have to get over, is it's not training your people. It's repetitively training your people is that second pillar.
100%. Love it. Well, everybody, I know that you've been filled with a lot of great information and best practices that you can implement into your business as well today, no matter what your industry is. You know, we do have listeners here from the ortho industry, dental industry, chiropractic industry. It doesn't matter what your industry is. Everything that Brian said, it fills in the blanks that you need to be successful inside of your business. So, Brian, thank you for being here today and sharing this information with us.
I appreciate you having me on. It's my pleasure. And you know, this exposure we're getting is, we just want to help. We get more pleasure out of helping other people and seeing them succeed than I do out of seeing my own company or companies succeed. We just want to help, and it's an industry that needs it in this time and beyond. So I appreciate you having me.
Totally agree. Thank you so much. Everybody, remember again, if you got what you wanted out of this episode, make sure to share it with your friends and colleagues. Let them know that there is a place that they can find the best practices, and reach out to Brian. All of the information, the books that he mentioned, the way to connect with him, it'll all be in the show notes as well. So please check those out. And everybody, thank you again for watching and listening to the show. As always, our goal here is to help you be more proactive, productive, and profitable in all areas of your life and business. We'll see you on the next episode, everyone. Thanks so much again for listening to the Propreneur Podcast. We really appreciate your support. If you haven't subscribed already, please make sure you do so. Also, if you feel like you might be a good fit for our podcast as a guest, or know somebody who you think would be, go ahead and email us at dino@dinowatt.com. Again, thanks for support. We'll see you on the next episode.